Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everyone out this morning. And I know we've prayed for rain for a period of time, and now it looks like we've gotten plenty of it. Unfortunately, it makes the grass grow. We have to mow more often. But we're thankful for the rain, and we're grateful and thankful for all of you being here this morning. Let me cover a couple of announcements. Hopefully, you observe the announcements that scroll across our screen as you're waiting for the service to start. But this morning by the bathrooms upstairs, there was a happy birthday, have fun, gift card from Walmart. I don't know who it belongs to. If nobody claims it, I'm going to have fun with it. So it may not be anything on it. Who's it belong to? Oh. Anyway, if it's yours, it's up here. So. Also, if you ask for a DVD of It's a Miracle, our special patriotic presentation, there's a stack of them out there. Whitney made them for you. So if you ask for one, be sure and pick it up. And also, if you'd like to have DVDs of the service, they are available. We don't want to make too many, so if you just like every Sunday to have one, just let Whitney know, and she can make up a number of them for us. Okay. Any other announcements?
Yes. Okay. And hopefully you got some of these sheets of paper. You remember the big slogan contest? Huge. Well, I thought we could announce a winner today, but no, the section said you won't need these shoes. They pass the button. So anyway, just all you have to do is you're circling your choice. The one that you might be best. If it's a tie, circle two. Don't circle all of them. And then you put them in that box right up here that's on the table. That'd be great. Hopefully we'll have a winner by next week. You want me to give people to stand up? No? All right, well, let me just say, the feast was put in, these were suggested by people from all ages of the congregation. So it's tremendous. We have come together from younger than teens, and in teens, we have some for people who are, what did they say last night? Seasoned veterans. That was what they said. Seasoned veterans. And we have some anywhere in between. Okay, so I think you'll have a good time reading them. Any one of them would be great.
Okay. All right. I want to encourage you take note about the Spirit-Filled Fellowship potluck tonight. If you've not tried that service, come out. We're going to have a potluck at 5, and then we'll start our service and hopefully be done around 7:30. So we'll invite you to do that. And had a great time last night with Burrow's 80th birthday. And had some great food, great music, and just a good time celebrating with Burl. Any other announcements? Okay, let me do birthdays and then.
I need to know about Doe River by next
Sunday. Okay, Doe River. If you're going, we need to know by next Sunday. Okay. Good. Anything else? Right, let me cover birthdays. Today is Marvin Renna's birthday. So Marty, pass on to him happy birthday for us. And 24th, Samantha's got a birthday. Happy birthday, Samantha. And then Heather Hayes has a birthday on the 25th. So those are birthdays and anniversaries. All right, let's bow our heads. We have a word of prayer. Begin our service. And Father, we thank you today for this opportunity we have to come together to worship. Thank you for each person's here. We pray, Lord, for your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Jesus himself, to be in our midst. We know he already is, but in a special way today that he will touch our lives, open our hearts and minds to hear your word, and help us to respond in faith to what you have to say to us and for us today. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Welcome to our worship this morning. You know that we're not here by accident, but each one of us is called by name because we are infinitely valuable to our Heavenly Father. Before this world was created, He had plans for you. And so today He's called you here with the family at Cedar Creek to worship Him together. And as this lady said this morning, when we gather to worship, He shows up. The canopy of heaven today is open for you. And don't leave this place without taking Him whatever need that you have, whatever brokenness you have, whatever. He's ready and waiting, and the answer is always yes. Today, the hymn of praise is When Morning Gilds the Skies, and we look forward to welcoming the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ with our introing.
Your glory, God.
Let's continue our worship as we spend a moment of confession, recognizing that we are sinners. We all fall short of God's glory, but He's faithful and just to forgive us if we will confess. After a moment of silent prayer and confession, we'll sing our response. So let's bow as we pray and confess. Father, you've heard our confession. Now let your grace, the grace from your hand, be upon us. Amen.
Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be.
Singing for us this morning. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to our responsive reading. It's from the 12th chapter of Luke, verses 1 through 12. You should have the scriptures on the screen, but if you're using a Pew Bible, the page number is in your bulletin this morning. I'll start with verse 1. We'll alternate reading as we usually do, and then we'll all read together. Verse 12. Meanwhile, when a crowd of many thousands had gathered so that they were trampling on one another, Jesus began to speak first to his disciples, saying, "Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy.
There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known.
What you have said in the dark will be heard in the daylight, and what you have whispered in the ear in the inner rooms will be proclaimed from the roofs.
I tell you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that can do no more.
But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after the killing of the body, has the power to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him.
Are not five sparrows sold for two pennies? Yet not one of them is forgotten by God.
Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows.
I tell you, whoever acknowledges me before men over others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge me before the angels of God.
But he who disowns me before men will be disowned before the angels of God.
And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But anyone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven.
When you are brought before synagogues, rulers, and authorities, do not worry about how you will defend yourselves or what you will say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time what you should say. May the Lord bless to us the reading and hearing of His holy word. My sermon hymn is Wonderful Grace of Jesus. It's number 114. We're using my hymn book. And we'll dismiss children on the last verse for Children's Church.
Bibles. To the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit to the churches says to the churches. And I believe the Holy Spirit is asking us today, are we a lukewarm church? Are we hot or cold? I think it's time we make a choice.
Thank you, Becky, for reading for us this morning. I want to look at this scripture and others this morning about taking our spiritual temperature. Laodicea, if you have read Revelations 2 and 3, was the last church in Revelation to whom the Holy Spirit addressed in John's letter, which we now know as the book of Revelation. And if you go back and read all the addresses to the seven churches, we see both a combination of praise and criticism, of encouragement and a warning. But always at the end of every section, there's this address from the Spirit to the seven churches, or maybe an exhortation to some of the seven churches. And Baker read this morning at the end, anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. Of course, Revelation 2 and 3 clearly addresses seven historic churches in what is now modern-day Turkey, which was then considered the province of Asia. But the question we want to deal with this morning, and is one I think is has a pretty clear answer, can these letters also be addressed to our churches today? I think the answer is obviously yes. That we see in our modern day churches similar parallels between these seven early churches. The other question is, are these descriptions in the seven churches also descriptions of individual Christians? Of individual believers? And I think the answer obviously can be yes. That we can find ourselves in each of these descriptions of the seven churches. Sometimes encouraging and praise, sometimes maybe criticism and a warning. But I want to go back and look at several of the verses in our sermon scripture this morning about the church of Laodicea. I want to start with verse 15 because it has a very important phrase at the very beginning of this section that should be an important phrase for each one of us, as well as not only the churches of Asia Minor or churches in our modern world today. And go back and look at the first part of verse 15. The Spirit says, I know all the things you do. You know, and a lot of times we kind of pass over that phrase, but think about the impact of that phrase. Think about the implication of that phrase. I know all the things that you do. That's also a common phrase in some of the other descriptions of the churches that the Spirit spoke to in Revelation. To go back to what he said to the church in Ephesus, I know all the things that you do. I've seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know all the things that you do to the church at Philadelphia. And I've opened a door for you that no one can close. And this morning to the church at Laodicea, I know all the things that you do, that you're neither hot nor cold. And I think the first step in to taking our spiritual temperature is to come to the realization that we must be honest about our spiritual condition. Because God already knows the truth about where we are spiritually. And that's an important point about the beginning of verse 15. I know all that you do. And that clearly lets us know that nothing we do is hidden from God. He already knows our spiritual condition before we even try to take our spiritual temperature. Psalm 94:10 says, He knows everything. Doesn't He also know what you are doing? You know, that's a scary thought, isn't it? For some people. You know, sometimes we talk to our kids and they say, well, how do you know that? You know, and sometimes I think parents, we have an extra sense of knowing what kids do when we don't even see what they're doing. And that's exactly why the Spirit is saying to the church at Laodicea, just as He said to the other churches, God already knows the truth about where we are spiritually. He knows what we're doing. One time Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, a religious group who viewed themselves as mature and devout. And He said to them, you like to appear righteous in public, but God knows your heart. That's Luke 16, verse 15. How many of us would fit in that category? That we have this outward appearance of piety and maturity and devotion, but yet something else is going on inside of our hearts. If we were really honest sometimes, we would just go ahead and admit that maybe our Christian persona is just a mask. It really is hiding our true nature, or maybe trying to cover up something that we think no one else knows, including God. These passages say very clearly that the Holy Spirit removes the mask that we try to cover up with. And He tells us who we really are. Isn't that why He began verse 15 with, I know all the things that you do? You know, accepting the reality that often who we say we are isn't the true reality of who we are is the first step in taking our spiritual temperature. Just being honest. That's why we have confession time. Lord, I claim to be a Christian, but this last week, here's some thoughts that I had, here's some things that I did that doesn't reflect who I should be in Christ. So maybe that first step in taking our spiritual temperature is just be honest. I'm not who I claim to be sometimes. The second phrase in there that's important is what the Spirit said to the Laodicean church. You're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other. Notice kind of the two options there. We can either be hot for the things of God, fired up in our faith, putting our faith into action every day, or we can be cold toward God, rejecting Him and rejecting all of His promises. The reality of the church at Laodicea was that they chose another option. They chose to be lukewarm. They didn't take a stand for anything. They were indifferent to what God wanted them to be and what God wanted them to do. They had become hardened and self-satisfied. But look at verse 16. Where the Spirit said to them, but since you are a lukewarm, you're like lukewarm water. You're neither hot nor cold. And for that reason, I will spit you out of my mouth. That term, lukewarm water, came from the water supply of Laodicea. Laodicea did not have a really good supply of fresh water. So it was piped in by aqueduct from the mountains. And in the mountains of the hot spring, and this hot water was piped many miles through the aqueduct down to Laodicea. But by the time it got to the city, it was neither hot nor cold. It was only lukewarm. Years ago, when I was very small, and my grandfather was still alive, at breakfast time, my grandmother, back in those days, we didn't have Mr. Coffees and those kind of things, so you'd boil the coffee on the pot on the wood stove, and it'd be very hot. And he would take his coffee and pour it out of the cup into the saucer, and then he'd blow on it to cool it, and then he would drink from the saucer. Anybody, any of your grandparents or parents ever did that? Yeah. The problem is the coffee was lukewarm by that time, because I would sample it. It wasn't hot. It wasn't cold. It was just lukewarm. I don't like lukewarm coffee. Do you? I like mine hot. In fact, sometimes I'll put it in the microwave to heat it up. Get it a little bit hotter. Skip this one for you. The English drink their beer warm. How many of you like your beer warm? No, you better not answer that. Just leave that one alone. Right? We can just assume. Americans don't like warm beer. They like it cold. But in the eyes of God, according to this letter to and this word to Laodicea, in the eyes of God, there's nothing more disgusting than a half-hearted, nominal, lukewarm Christian who is self-sufficient. Let me say that again. In the eyes of God, there is nothing more disgusting than a half-hearted, nominal Christian, lukewarm, who is self-sufficient. Now, for those of you who automatically puckered up over that, I didn't say that. The Scripture said it. Jesus, the Spirit of Jesus said it. Because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out. Much the same if we drank something that was lukewarm that we just didn't like, we might just spit it back in the cup. The second step to taking our spiritual temperature is to accept the truth that there may be three spiritual temperatures that we have to deal with, and sometimes we may fall in each one of these. We can be hot for the things of God, or we can be cold and indifferent toward God. Or we can be somewhere in the middle, just lukewarm. So what is God's advice to us so that we don't find ourselves in two of those three categories? That instead of being cold or lukewarm and indifferent, we are hot and turned on to the things of God. What was his advice to us? Verse 18. And that's the wonderful thing about God. He doesn't just lay some kind of label on us and leave us there. He says, here, let me help you move from being cold and lukewarm to being hot for the things of the kingdom. So in verse 18, this is from the New Living Translation. God's advice to us. So I advise you to. And we're going to deal with a couple of these. So I advise you to buy gold from me. Gold that has been purified by fire. Gold here represents real spiritual treasures. In Matthew 6:19, Jesus speaks about and spoke about real treasures. He said, don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal. Skip over to verse 21 of Matthew 6. He says, but wherever your treasure is there the desires of your heart will also be. Another way to say this is, where we put our priorities reflects the spiritual warmth and condition of our heart. Where we put our priorities reflects the spiritual warmth and condition of our hearts. That was God's first advice to us. Buy gold from me, the real spiritual treasures. The second advice, he says, I advise you to buy white garments from me so that you will not be ashamed by your nakedness. The white garments there represents the righteousness of God. The lukewarm Christians in Laodicea believed in their own righteousness. They may have said something to each other like, well, we go to church. That makes me righteous, doesn't it? I put money in the offering plate. Doesn't that make me righteous? I've got a Bible at home. Doesn't that make me righteous? I pray when we eat every day, and when things kind of get bad, I'll really crank up my prayer life. That makes me righteous, doesn't it? True righteousness comes from God. The Laodiceans believed in their own self-efficiency, their own self-righteousness, the things that they did. But righteousness comes from God. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13. It says, we're looking forward to the new heavens and new earth that he has promised, a world filled with God's righteousness. When we surrender our lives totally to God, committed 100%, His righteousness becomes our righteousness. It's not based on who we are, what we do. It's what we accept as a gift from God. And this righteousness of God is always available to us. Jesus said that Himself in John 16:10. He says, righteousness is now available because I go to the Father. When Jesus died on the cross, He made a personal relationship with God possible and available to each one of us. We are made righteous through what Jesus did on the cross. When we confess our sins, we confess our coldness or our lukewarmness, God can declare us righteous, and He delivers us from the judgment for our sins. We're going with verse 19 of our sermon scripture this morning. And look what it says about how God begins to work in our lives, to put us on the right path, to bring us back to that fire of our devotion instead of that lukewarmness that we can settle into very easily. Verse 19, the Spirit said, I correct and discipline everyone I love. So be diligent and turn from your indifference. Are any of us lukewarm toward God in our devotion to Him? What the scripture is saying is that God may discipline us to help us out of our lukewarm attitude. But He always uses loving discipline. It's not punishment. It's correction. To bring us out of the coldness, or bring us out of the lukewarmness, and into the fire of what He wants us to be and to do as Christians. But we can avoid that discipline by drawing near to Him through our confession, through our service, through our worship, through our study of His Word, through our obedience to His Word. The Holy Spirit can reignite our passion for God when we allow the Spirit of Jesus to work in our hearts, to heat up that lukewarmness, to overcome that coldness. And none of us have an excuse for being lukewarm toward God in either what we do or what we believe. This church has opportunity after opportunity after opportunity for each one of us to reignite that passion for God. How many Bible studies do we have going? Sometimes I can't even keep up with them. How many prayer groups are going? I have to look at the schedule just to see what's happening today. That's why we started Spirit-Filled Fellowship 3 years ago. Because a group of 12 people said, we want to have that same fire and passion that the early church had, to see the same things that happened then, to see them happen now. Miracles, signs, wonders. But yet how many of us pass up the opportunity every day to be a part of either a prayer group or Bible study that could reignite that passion for God? Here's the good news, though. God is always ready to release a fresh wind and a fresh fire into our lives. Look at verse 20. And this is a key verse. Because it's each of our invitation and opportunity. The Spirit says, Jesus said, the Spirit of Jesus, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. That's pretty simple, isn't it? Jesus stands at the door of our hearts because he wants to save us and he wants to have fellowship with us. He's also patient, but he's also persistent in how he tries to get through to us. Jesus doesn't break and enter like a thief would. But the Bible says he knocks. And he allows us to decide whether or not to open the door of our lives to him. And here's the good news. And this is good news for the cold. It's a good news for the lukewarm. His life-changing presence and power is on the other side of the door. And he constantly knocks. And the question for us today is, are you willing to open the door and let him fire you up spiritually? Or is it easier just to stay cold and indifferent and lukewarm? And the answer depends on each one of us, doesn't it? I have to answer to the knock as well as you have to answer the knock. And it's what you do in response to the knock that will make the difference between you being cold and indifferent, being lukewarm, or on fire for God. That's a choice, isn't it? It's a choice that you and I have to face. It's a choice you and I have to make. To open the door or just let him keep knocking. You remember, God is persistent. He's patient. But the other piece of the news and the other piece of the puzzle is, when does the time run out? And I don't know the answer to that one. I do know the answer and the cure for being lukewarm, and that is to open the door of your heart and let God come in all his fullness and power, to reignite that passion for the things of God. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, right now, here in this place, there are some that responded to your word. There are some that in their heart said, I hear you knocking. I'm going to open the door. Father, we know too there are others who close their ears. Even though you warn us that if you have ears to hear, let us listen and understand. But there's still some that keeps that door closed. We thank you that you keep on knocking, though. We pray that there will be those who do hear that knocking and will open that door. Father, help each one of us have that passion for you and the things of your kingdom to be reignited, to become involved, to participate, to to take the opportunity that's offered here every day in our own church to find expression for our faith, whether it's through Bible study or prayer group, whether it's picking up our Bible at home and opening it up and reading it. But help us to not be lukewarm. As the Spirit said, as you said in your word, I'd rather you be hot or cold instead of being lukewarm. So Father, today, for those that want to respond, I ask that you move them to do something to get them out of that lukewarm condition and turn on to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn is Revive Us Again. It's number 574, if you're going to use a hymn book. I encourage you to let the Word speak to you and let the Spirit move you as He desires and as far as you are willing. Revive us again. But they did find her body, so I want to be in prayer for this family. They own the Mexican restaurant on the right side going into Jonesboro, and her family owned it. So anyway, be in prayer for that family. And also the last of the girls who were injured at the fair went home, so that's a praise, and we want to continue to pray for Bobby Reynolds' complete recovery from her injuries. And also Nancy asked we pray for Gabe Goins, who is continuing to run a fever, and they think it may be associated with mosquitoes, bites or something. So they're not really sure what the infection is, but I'll be in prayer for Gabe. So.
Anyone else we need to?
I think I just cut out.
I'm pray for Cody. He's going to have stroke for Cedar.
What's he doing?
He's going to have stroke
for Cedar. Stroke for Cedar. Okay. Yeah. Cody Landers is going to be having a scope procedure done this week. Leon, where's he going? Oh, Dallas. Okay. Bill is going to Dallas for some training, I gather, with his dog. Is his dog going with him? Okay.
All right. I have
two. For Dalton Justice, his mom got killed in a car accident this weekend. Dalton Justice.
His mother was killed in a car wreck.
Okay.
Yeah, he goes to South Green.
Hmm?
He goes to South Green.
Okay, he goes to South Green. Okay.
And then my friend Daniel that I was talking about, they were hoping to have him back in school by October. But now they're having to do such aggressive treatments that he's not even going to get to come back to Johnson City until Christmas.
Okay.
So he'll be at St. Jude until December now.
Okay. Dalton Justice's mother was killed in a wreck, and he goes to South Green. And the young man, Daniel, that we prayed for last week, now won't get home until Christmas time, be back in school, hopefully after Christmas. Okay. Okay. Cody. Got it. Anyone else? Okay. The people affected by the flood. Okay. Fires. Okay. Anyone else? Well, remember these in your prayer time, and let's go to the Lord in a time of prayer. Father, we thank you that not only you know everything about us, you know the condition of our hearts, but you know what our needs are, even before we speak them. But you consistently, over and over, stress the importance of prayer. That Jesus prayed. He prayed for his disciples. He prayed for those of us who would believe because of the disciples. Praying for those of us that would live thousands of years after his time, but he understood the importance of praying for people's needs. And so this morning we come to you believing the power of prayer, Father, the power to heal, the power to restore, the power to convict, the power to change direction in our lives. And so from this morning we ask for your presence and your power to be with each of the needs that we have shared this morning. Put all those on our prayer list. Lord, you would touch every need with your power and your presence. And we're particularly this morning reminded of the needs of this family, this young 20-year-old woman who disappeared more than a week ago, but now we know the final outcome. And we ask for peace and comfort and encouragement for this family. We pray that you will be close to them as they try to overcome just overwhelming grief and questions of why and what happened. But uphold them in your arms and help them during these very difficult days. We do give you our praise today for Riley Reynolds coming home from the hospital after this Ferris wheel accident. Father, pray She will have a complete recovery. There'll be no permanent effects from her accident. She'll be back even stronger than she was before. We pray for Gabe Goins too, his fever. Even though the doctors do not understand the source of it, we believe in your healing power to touch him, to restore him back to his health. We pray that you be with Cody this week as he has a scope procedure done. And Father, we're going to believe that there'll be nothing there for them to see. And Father, that would be confirmation to his parents and to his family that he's healthy. He's healed. Father, we ask you to be with Bill as he travels to Dallas, that you protect him, watch over him. Father, be with Shasta and Kason and Kaler, that you watch over them while Bill's away. Father, we pray for Dalton Justice, this young man who lost his mother. Father, that you will give him your peace and strength and uplift him in every way and encourage him during this time of loss. We pray for this young man, Daniel, we prayed for last week. The treatments will be taking longer than first anticipated. But Father, we pray for his complete recovery and his return to his school. Even sooner than they say, even though the medical folks say in Christmas time he'll be back. But Father, we pray for his healing today. And we do pray, Lord, for the victims of the floods there in Louisiana. 40,000 homes affected, and all those families who've been disrupted and lost everything they own. Father, that you would encourage them as well. And for those who are victims of the fires in California, Father, you be there for them in their time of need. We do remember, Father, the tragedy of that bombing at the wedding in Turkey, where so many lives were lost. And an event that should have been one of great happiness and joy, that now has turned to sorrow. And Father, that you would be there with the victims' families. And Father, the big issue of terrorism in the world, Father, this evil, we know your word has already said, will be brought to justice. We pray for that justice to come soon for them. And Father, too, today is we bow before you. We're reminded of what your scripture challenges us to be. It's to be on fire for you, not to be lukewarm, and not to be cold. And we know we can't do that on our own, but we need the presence of your Holy Spirit to do that, to reignite that fire in each one of us, to set us on fire for you. We thank you that that's possible for us today. And all it takes for us is to open that door when we hear that knock. And that knock is constant. It's always, every day. Father, we thank you today for your Son who does stand at the door of our hearts and knock. We thank you for what he's done for us through his life and death and resurrection. We thank you for the example he set for us, not only how to live, but how we ought to pray, as he taught his disciples and for us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue our worship as we bring to God our morning tithes and offerings.